You're watching Tag TV.
Hello viewers, I'm your host Uzma Jafri with another episode of South Asia Focus. Let's begin the show with India, whose External Affairs Minister Sushma Swaraj, in a bid to further bolster country's bilateral ties with Russia, attended the 23rd India-Russia Intergovernmental Commission on Technical and Economic Cooperation, which was co-chaired by her and the Deputy Prime Minister of the Russian Federation, Yuri Borisov. A report.
Indian External Affairs Minister Sushma Swaraj, who was on her third Russian visit in last 11 months, attended the 23rd IRIGC-TEC annual meet, which aims at reviewing ongoing activities of bilateral cooperation in the fields of bilateral trade and investment, science and technology, culture and other issues of mutual interest. She co-chaired the meeting with Russian Deputy Prime Minister Yuri Borisov. Both the leaders discussed the entire gamut of bilateral ties, putting special stress at further deepening the years-long alliance and camaraderie. The two countries, India and Russia, share a special relationship, and India is the second largest market for Russian defense industry. Between 2000 and 2014, 73% of India's imported military equipment came from Russia. And in 2017 alone, 68% of the Indian military's hardware imports came from Moscow.
भारत और रूस के बीच एक विशिष्ट और गौरवपूर्ण रणनीतिक साझेदारी है। ये साझेदारी समय के प्रवाह के साथ और अधिक मजबूत हुई है और इसकी कार्यसूची भी बहुत विस्तृत है। ये साझेदारी मानवीय गतिविधियों के लगभग सभी पहलुओं को छूती है। भारत रूस के साथ अपने संबंधों को सर्वाधिक महत्व देता है। उप प्रधानमंत्री श्री बोरिसोव और मैंने हमारे संबंधों की विस्तृत समीक्षा की। हमारे बीच हुई बैठक के परिणामों से मैं पूरी तरह संतुष्ट हूँ।
The economic ties between the two countries too have significantly been growing in importance, with India and Russia setting a target of bilateral trade of over $30 million by 2025. Bilateral trade between both countries grew by over 24% in 2012 and has only been increasing ever since. The visit coincidentally followed the historic Indo-US 2+2 meet, which was held earlier in the month in Indian capital New Delhi. India and Russia have shared elaborate and splendid relations over the years, and India's current inclination towards United States have not affected the relationship.
In the line of improving its diplomatic engagements globally, India has made some effective adjustments in its foreign policy in recent times. Moving on, the incidents of enforced disappearances are on a constant rise in Balochistan, the territory that has been reeling under Pakistan's clutches for 7 decades. However, the pervasive atrocities have not gathered much international traction owing to Pakistan's continuous check on the flow of information. Exiled Balochs, however, have been relentlessly carrying out protests, rallies and conferences to spread awareness of the massive subjugation. We have a report.
The human rights situation in Balochistan is witnessing an unprecedented decline as the state agencies of Pakistan are on a rampage, alleged the Baloch political activists and human rights activists while interacting with the media at the Geneva Press Club. The conference organized by Baloch Voice Association was addressed by Professor Naila Kadri Baloch, Mama Kadar Baloch and other human rights activists who highlighted the issue of arbitrary detentions, enforced disappearances and killings of political and human rights activists in Pakistan. Naila Kadri Baloch, who is heading the World Baloch Women's Forum, said that Pakistan has been exploiting all the resources of Balochistan and later using it as a dump yard, not caring for the lives of the citizens.
Many times Pakistan has approved has proved that they just need the land of Balochistan. They need our gold, they need our oil, they need our minerals, they need our deep sea ports to sell them to China, but they need our land for their proxy nuclear tests. The Chinese nuclear test they did on the soil of Balochistan, 5 nuclear bombs they blasted on the soil of Balochistan, and for 6 years there was no rain, there was drought, still the 90% of wildlife died in Balochistan.
Ever since Pakistan has signed the multi-billion dollar CPEC deal with China, the number of atrocities has grown rapidly.
Who has given them right to sell Balochistan to China? If we stood up against them and we said that Balochistan is an occupied territory and Pakistan has no right to sell Gwadar seaport or any part of Balochistan for any mega project or any CPAC kind of destructive projects, what happened? I myself is a testimony. I got beaten up. I got, as a professor, a university professor, got beaten up by the idiots of Pakistan Army. I got imprisoned. And I, and in the middle of the night, 1 o'clock, I was without any warrants, without any paperwork, I was detained. And in the middle of night, in cantonment, a police station.
Her husband was abducted by state agencies for a mere dare of trying to make a film on the prevailing human rights situation. Voice for Missing Baloch Person says that Pakistan has killed more than 100,000 innocent Baloch ever since it forcefully occupied the territory. Mama Kader Baloch, Vice President of Voice for Baloch Missing Persons, VBMP, who has come to Geneva to attend a 39th session of the Human Rights Council.
Because the Balochistan are saying that Pakistan are saying Pakistan Balochistan are saying that 70 years old, 70 years old, Nanto are saying Balochato, Dagra, Manningati, Afing, Dunning, Halling, Mashteti, Nana Chunati, Rarati, Zinda Zinda Dafan Kanning, وہ تو میں نن تو میڈیا بلوچستان تھی چونکہ میڈیا اللہ تو نن لسٹر جوڑ کرنے یا نن کسے تینا تھواری سرکننگ کرنے تو اون افتے اگر اساب کے تو لکھا تی تھی دا افتے بلوچ لا پتہ مسنے یا انہا لاشق ملانے
قادر told media that he had a documented data of more than 45,000 people who have been abducted or killed by the army and other security forces of Pakistan.
In Pakistan, one can say very easily, there is no rule of law. There is, of course, parliament is existing, judiciary claims itself as an independent institution, and other institutions are also claiming that they are independent and working democratically and this and that. But the military is the supreme body and which has all the powers, which is controlling the whole country. Now, how a man is disappeared in the presence of judiciary, parliament and other institutions? Because this is a total failure of the law in the country. There is no rule of law. The country has proved itself that there is no criminal justice system. Even the judges are saying that criminal justice system is failed because that military does not want that any institution should interfere into it.
The conference was moderated by Munir Mengel, the head of Baloch Voice Association, and attended by Sardar Shaukat Ali Kashmiri, Fazal Rehman Afridi, and Randy Hengen Spiderwald, a Norwegian lawyer and legal representative of Ehsan Ajermendi, a Baloch activist missing in Pakistan. Earlier, the European Organization for Pakistani Minorities, which has been working extensively for the rights of the oppressed, highlighted the issue of enforced disappearances in Balochistan during the ongoing 39th session of the UN Human Rights Council. It put banners in front of the United Nations office in Geneva with pictures of some of the missing political activists in them that are reflective of an increasingly grim human rights situation in Pakistan. The organization has sought UN support into the issue and asks for fact-finding team to visit Pakistan and help victims who are allegedly lodged in secret detention centers.
Moving on, the political situation in Maldives continues to deteriorate before the presidential elections slated later this month. The opposition has launched a spate of political attacks on the incumbent President Abdullah Yameen, calling him an autocrat who has used excessive and disproportionate force to muzzle the voice of opposition. The opposition also accused the Yameen government of taking outside help to overthrow the democratic structure of the country. We have Mr. NN Jha, a former Indian ambassador to Maldives, who has been closely observing the evolving developments in the country. Mr. Jha, how do you analyze the current political situation of Maldives, especially the run-up where the opposition has accused President Yameen of rigging the elections beforehand?
You know, the situation there is very tense and very unfortunate that a lovely little island like that is going through all these travails. Actually, the former president, Nasheed, others have been alleging, right from day one, that the elections are going to be rigged in favor of the present president. And this is quite obvious from the fact that his own half-brother, he also locked up. His half-brother's daughter, who was a minister there, has ceased to be a minister. And many other people have been arrested or disqualified. So this means that he is determined to win for himself. So it's very likely, I would say, not really quite likely, that the elections will be rigged. And I would say that a rigged election with the same lot coming back to power there would be very dangerous, could be dangerous for India.
Do you think it is the growing influence and support of China which is emboldening Yameen?
I think that's very much true. Very true that he knows that he has the full support of China. China has already taken care of, acquired through purchase, a couple of islands. Then it inaugurated a bridge the other day, just about a week ago or 10 days ago, built with Chinese aid, which connects the capital with the airport area, airport island. And there are constant visits between China and Maldives. Not only that, the Pakistani experts have also grown there. And large number of Maldives people, a large percentage for their small population, has gone to Middle East to fight for ISIS. So we have both these dangers which are confronting India. And what I would do is, even well before the elections are held and before they are announced, the results are known, we should decide what plan of action we'll take.
European Union has threatened the country with the imposition of sanctions, citing the increasingly autocratic situation in the country. Do you think India should also step in to protect democracy in its neighborhood?
Yes, certainly. I think we are a democratic country and we should not be ashamed or hesitant in protecting fellow democrats. You remember in India one time, there was some sort of understanding arrived at between the democracies of the world. I mean, that never really got off in a big way, but we can now think in terms of getting it off in a big way. But we should be clear in our mind that we want a democratic, duly elected, fairly government in that island, which will be good for India. Otherwise, Chinese influence are growing leaps and bounds almost every day.
Thank you, Mr. Jha. Moving on, an upper house lawmaker, Pramila Kumari in Nepal, has questioned Prime Minister KP Oli's treatment of the marginalized community and has urged him to fulfill the promises he made before the elections in the Himalayan nation. Oli, in the run-up to the elections, had promised to amend the constitution for the upliftment of the communities that lag behind in the Human Development Index, which includes the Madhesi community. But the Prime Minister has done nothing for the marginalized community, says the Madhesi legislator. We have a report.
Madheshi lawmaker Pramila Kumari, a member of Nepal's upper house and the representative from the Federal Socialist Forum, demanded for fulfillment of commitments made by Prime Minister KP Oli to amend the constitution. Oli, in his quest for power, had promised to amend the constitution for the upliftment of communities such as Madhesis, Muslims, Dalits, women and the indigenous people who lag behind in the Human Development Index.
यसै सदनमा हाम्रो सम्माननीय प्रधानमन्त्री ज्यूले एउटा प्रतिबद्धता जाहिर गर्नु भएको थियो त्यो म स्मरण गराउन चाहन्छु ह्युमन डेभलपमेन्ट इन्डेक्समा पछि परेका समुदाय मधेसी जनजाति आदिवासी दलित महिला मुस्लिम थारू का हक हितमा संविधान निश्चित रूपले संशोधन गर्छु भन्ने प्रतिबद्धता उहाँले जाहिर गर्नु भएको थियो तर अहिलेसम्म हाम्रो प्रधानमन्त्री ज्यूले कुनै किसिमको चासो देखाउनु भएको छैन हाम्रो सम्माननीय अध्यक्ष महोदय र माननीय सदस्यहरूलाई साक्षी राखेर मैले नै संविधान संशोधन गर्नको लागि विधेयक मैले प्रस्ताव दर्ता गराएको थिए संशोधन प्रस्ताव उहाँले प्रतिबद्धता जाहिर गर्नु भएको थियो
कुमारी while addressing the meeting of upper house also questioned Oli's intentions regarding the promises he had made and lamented his government's treatment of Madhesis as non-citizens
तर अहिले सम्म उहाँले कुनै किसिमको चासो देखाउनु भएको छैन के मधेसी जनता नेपाली होइन किन मधेसी जनतादेखि उहाँ यति के अरे हेप्नुहुन्छ मधेसीलाई के हामी नेपाली होइनौँ
Ever since Nepal promulgated its first ever federal parliament in September 2015, the Madhesi issue has been at the forefront of Nepal politics. Widespread protests in 2015 saw the constitution being burned by Madhesh-based parties and the bloodshed at that time led to deaths of over 100 protesters when KP Oli was in power. Last year, the Sher Bahadur Deoba-led government had tabled the constitution for amendment, but his proposal was rejected as it failed to garner the required two-third majority.
Moving on, we now take you to the Charlie Chaplin of Afghanistan. A 25-year-old stand-up comedian whose only aim is to give the citizen of the war-torn country a reason to smile. Kareem Asir Aka, the Afghan Chaplin, performs across the capital Kabul in Chaplin's trademark, oversized shoes, baggy pants, cane and black bowler and fills the audience with great joy and gives them a reason to forget and forego their grief for the time he performs. South Asia Focus has a report.
In war-torn Afghanistan, a 25-year-old stand-up comedian who impersonates Charlie Chaplin has become a source of inspiration and laughter for the people whose lives otherwise are demonized by the Taliban insurgents, whose violent acts have taken away hundreds of lives. Kareem Asir, who spent his childhood days in Iran and his family had fled after the hardline Taliban took control of Afghanistan in 1996, returned to his homeland after getting motivation for Chaplin shows from Iran and TV. Upon his return, he started performing in capital Kabul as Afghan's own Charlie Chaplin, wearing makeup and recreating Chaplin's characters in his performances, giving his country a fresh reason to smile. Albe only for the time he performs.
اس که ما نمایشات تئاتر خیابانی را به شکل چارلی چاپلین افغانی ساختیم که اینجا میخوایم که از طریق از اینمی نمایشای خود که یعنی یک سرگرمی داره یک پیام برای مردم برسونیم که بیشتر فعلا کارهای ما روی همین فرهنگ شهرنشینی محیط زیست اینا است.
One who has witnessed suicide attacks, explosions and faced threats from hardline Islamic militant groups for putting up un-Islamic performances, Asir feared attacks during or outside the venue of his shows. In Kabul, when his fans surround him to take selfies, he smiles but is constantly worried about attacks.
بدون شک یکی از اهداف ما این است که ما وقتی که همین برنامه را اندازی میکنیم که مردم برای یک لحظه فراموش کنند مشکلاتی که دارند، مشکلات جنگی که در افغانستان است، مشکلات وضعیت ناامنی که در افغانستان است، برای یک لحظه بتوانند فراموش کنند و یک سرگرمی را ببینند.
Asir performances, however, come as a huge respite for the people whose lives are constantly under threat due to frequent Taliban attacks in the country. Afghans who have seen the show say they enjoy the positive messages found in his performance. Some are even happier to learn Asir is Afghan himself. However, under the Taliban's rule from 1996-2001, most cultural activities were banned because they were seen as anti-Islamic.
Kareem Asir's live performances provide a brief respite in a city that routinely sees hell under constant fear of attacks by the Taliban and other insurgents. Moving on to India, where festive fervor is sweeping the country as Lord Ganesha made his entry for this year's Hindu festival, Ganesh Chaturthi. The 10-day festival began with devotees bringing home their beloved Ganesha clay idols to celebrate his birth. Celebrated across the country, the festival is best experienced in India's financial capital, Mumbai. We have a report.
Lord Ganesha yet again made a grand entry in India's financial capital, Mumbai, as thousands of devotees welcomed the Hindu elephant god with great fervour while taking his idol to their respective homes and community pandals in huge processions. Celebrated in honour of birthday of Lord Ganesha, considered to be the deity of prosperity and remover of obstacles by Hindus, Ganesh Chaturthi is celebrated for 10 days and the celebrations begin with the installation of the idols. All the barriers are swayed away as the festival unites people from across communities, different social and financial backgrounds, as they come together to offer prayers to their beloved Ganesha. This year too witnessed the unity in India's diversity as Muslims joined Hindus in bringing home the clay idols. The amalgamation of religions not only amplifies the celebration but also reaffirms the brotherhood that exists in the country.
बहुत अच्छा त्यौहार है इसमें सब मिल के जाते हैं आप देखो कितने मुसलमान लोग भी रहते हैं साथ में ऐसा नहीं कि मतलब हिंदू का त्यौहार है तो हिंदू अलग है मुसलमान अलग हम लोग सब साथ में रहते हैं हमारे त्यौहार में भी सब साथ में आते हैं
About 80% in India's 1.3 billion population are Hindus, but in recent years, these religious festivals and customs have come under increasing scrutiny as public awareness of environmental issues has been on a rise. Bollywood too joined the celebration and B-town actors called for an eco-friendly celebration of the festival. Reiterating the need for reserving environment for the future generations, Bollywood actor Anushka Sharma called for the devotees to look for eco-friendly alternatives.
हमारा ये एनवायरनमेंट है हमी को उसका देखरेख करनी है जिससे आगे जाके हमारी जो पीढ़ियां आने वाली हैं उनको उससे मदद मिले तो ऑफ कोर्स गणपति सब लोग धूमधाम से मनाएं और बहुत मजे से मनाएं बट केयरफुली भी मनाएं एंड एनवायरनमेंट को ध्यान रख के मनाएं तो आई थिंक सब लोगों के लिए अच्छा होगा
During the festival, elaborately painted and decorated idols are worshipped before mass processions. Take them to nearby rivers, lakes and the sea where they are immersed in accordance with Hindu faith.
On the 10th and the last day of the festival, the idols will be immersed in water after a procession of dancing and chanting devotees will say goodbye to their beloved god and request Bappa to return next year to again fill the country with hope and joy. With that, we come to the end of this week's episode. See you next week. Goodbye and take care.